start discussing about this, I would also like to know about the participants. I mean, what is their profile? Most of the participants are employed, working, or students as well?
Sir, there are many students and all on PhD research students and some of the assistant lecturers, assistant professors are also here.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going to start my presentation now. So moving to the first part, look at this. What does it suggest? Given the option at any point of time, 59% of the employees will be open to working elsewhere. What does this suggest? This suggests that organizations are not in a position to retain their people because of various reasons. It could be about the HR policies, it could be about their succession plan, about, right? So all this is related to basically that they are not able to manage their talent, either attract good talent, retain them. And this retention happens because they are not able to manage well, right? And that is why we have to consider and ensure that right talent is managed effectively by any organization. When I'm talking about any organization, it could be any kind of organization, a hospital, a IT sector employee, a defense, an academic institution, a manufacturing system, or a service organization. Moving further, before we talk about anything else, let us see, when we are talking about talent management, how do we define talent? Talent could be in various forms, like, and it is basically related to the knowledge, skill, experience of the people, because that is what make up and talent. And sometimes also say that it is an intrinsic gift that is given to a particular individual. For example, a person could be having a talent in singing, dancing, music, right? So that is something intrinsic in nature. That is also a part, that is also, you can call it a talent. It is also related to what you call judgment, attitude, character, drive or passion that people have for doing certain things. And the talent basically helps individual to learn and grow. Now, when we are talking about these things, that what is a talent? So we must understand that first we should try to see that in what form the talent is available in the organization. And then we move further to talk about the next thing, that is talent management. So when we are talking about talent management, we have to see that how it is defined, how we go about managing the talent. It all depends upon certain things, that what kind of processes an organization is adopting, right? So when we are discussing about talent management, we have to see what are the various processes through which we as an organization try to increase the value of the human capital. When I'm talking about human capital, basically it is a knowledge capital. And knowledge capital, you know, include what we have just discussed about the knowledge, skill, abilities of the people. So basically the idea of talent management is that you are going to have the right kind of talent in the organization who is going to contribute to organizational performance and add value to the organization. And for that matter, you will say that any organization would like to have this kind of talent who is going to add value to the organization by their contribution. Now, if you look at some of the key processes that we can adopt, is related to what you call the goal alignment. Goal alignment means that you have to ensure that the objectives of the organization and also the objectives of the individual gets aligned with these things in terms of their needs, expectations that they have from each other, right? You will not be able to manage your talent if you are not able to participate and contribute to the goals and objectives of the organization. Okay. Similarly, if organization is not able to take care of the needs and expectations, then the organization will not be able to manage the talent. So there's a need to align the goals and objectives of the individual and the employees, both in any organization. Then the next thing is how you recruit people in an organization. What is your selection process? And when we are talking about selection process, see, we do talk about two kind of things. That is, we are going to have a person job fit and a person environment fit, right? So when we are talking about the person job fit, you want to see that you are going to select the best candidate for the job given the constraints that you have, right? Sometimes you are not in a position to get the right kind of candidate. Sometimes right candidate will not join you. Okay, so there are a lot of issues related to selection, and then you have to see that how you can go for a better fit between the person and the job. Similarly, you also need to see that the person is not going to fit into the job but also fitting to the organization, the culture, norms, values. So he is going to adopt them so that he becomes a better fit for the organization and contributes. So their recruitment is very, very important. So any organization, if they are not able to recruit the right kind of talent, then it will be very difficult for them to get the kind of talent that they require for contributing to organization. Okay. The next point I am going to discuss is related to performance management. And when we are talking about performance management, it is very, very important. Okay. How you evaluate, how you give feedback, how you review their performance, and what you do based on performance management. So it also depends upon what kind of performance management system you are adopting, right? Whether your performance management is effective, it means that you are able to discriminate between talented employees and not so talented employees. Whether your performance system management system is linked with the reward or not, that you also need to look at. So if you adopt a fair and transparent performance management system, it is linked with the reward, basically it is going to help you to retain talent. Then employee development. See, most of the HRD or training and development activities are meant for what? They are supposed to contribute to the growth and development of skill and knowledge base of the employees. So basically we are talking about how we can go about developing talent in the organization, and in the process we have to see that what kind of strategies, I'm talking about the HR strategies, especially HRD strategies, we are adapting for the growth and development of the employees. There could be different kind of strategies that we can go for. For example, you can identify the training needs of the people, see what kind of requirement they have in terms of knowledge and skill. You train them so that they develop, and then you evaluate to see whether they are able to equip themselves with the kind of knowledge and skill that is required by the organization. In addition to training and development, we can also go for other kind of interventions like mentoring them. And especially if you look at the talent management system, mentoring is very helpful where a senior person in the organization is going to take the responsibility to develop the talent so that he better fits into the system and performs well, right? In addition to mentoring, we can go for coaching also. We can coach those people who are really well performing, and then we have to see that how they are going to contribute. The most important is that the kind of reward system that you are going to follow in an organization. It is very, very important that you are going to develop a reward system which is going to recognize the talent. So you need to differentiate your reward system in such a way so those who are doing well are rewarded well. You need to adopt certain systems and practices, especially related to the reward management, and you deliver it so that they feel that it is justified. Organization has done justice to them in terms of delivering reward, and based on that, you will be able to manage your talent, because reward is basically given for managing talent. It is not for developing. So if you look at these key processes, it talks about how we go about attracting through good selection process, how we manage them, especially through performance management and
sir, your mic is muted. Can you please unmute your mic?
Okay. Can you hear it?
Yes, sir. Please continue, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. So Now we are going to talk about the workforce. Now, if you look at
sir, yeah, it is muted again, please, sir. Can you turn on it one more time? I request all the participants, please do not mute the mic of the speaker or else they will be removed from the meeting.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Please continue.
Okay. So, see, we also look at the workforce and its characteristics today. Now, you know that the needs and expectations of the workforce is changing, right? So when we are talking about the workforce, I'm giving one statement, like living to work or working to live. Now you can differentiate the kind of workforce that we used to have earlier and the kind of workforce we have today. So when we're going to differentiate today's workforce, it is basically not working to live, but living to work. So they are working so that they can have a decent, good life. They can enjoy their life. So they have more balance in their other part, aspects of life and their professional life, right? So the needs and expectations of the workforce have changed. The composition of the workforce have changed, right? We have more female participation in the workforce today. We have very young younger generation who has participated in the workforce. Similarly, we also have older people who are part of the workforce. Now you have to see that with these composition and the kind of workforce characteristics that we have today, their needs, aspirations, and expectations are different. So with these things, we have to see whether this kind of workforce is suitable for your organization or not. And that is where we are talking about person job fit, whether the person is able to do his job properly and effectively or not. Irrespective of the composition, irrespective of their culture, irrespective of what their ethnicity is, we need to see that they are going to be suitable. And so that is where we are talking about the recruitment and the selection part. Basically, that is where we are talking about the acquisition part. Second important thing is that we have to ensure that the workforce which we have recruited have themselves engaged in the kind of activity that they are supposed to do and what is their level of commitment. Now, there's a lot of literature today that is available on employee engagement and commitment. And most of these literature suggests that employee engagement level in any kind of organization on an average is not more than 30 to 40%. So this is the range of engagement that employees have towards their work and job. So how can you expect an employee to perform well if their engagement level or commitment level is low? Right? So we need to ensure that you have such policies to manage people so that you are able to increase their engagement and commitment level so that they are able to perform well and contribute and add value to the organization. The next point is being flexible and adaptable. Yes, you also need to have people who are going to be more flexible and adaptive. What I mean by flexible and adaptive here means that you need to ensure that they are not going to perform one single job at one desk in a particular job, right? So you need people who are having more than one skill. They can adapt themselves to other kind of jobs immediately. And that is where we are talking about a workforce which is multi-skilled, who can go for multitasking. And that is why we are having these kind of issues today, because you know that today jobs are not important. Basically, we are moving from job focused system to a process focused system where there are processes and people are going to perform are being a part of one process, maybe recruitment, maybe supply chain, maybe marketing. So depending upon your knowledge and skill, you could be engaged in particular process. Once the process is over, then you move to the next process. And that is where flexibility and adaptiveness comes into the picture. And ultimately, everything boils down to performance, the bottom line. And that is where you also need to ensure that people are going to be productive. If they are not able to perform well, then they are not required. So you need to ensure that your workforce characteristics is aligned with this, the key processes, right? And that is where we have this picture where we are going to talk about how we're going to measure these processes, how we're going to comply with these things that, yes, this is there in the organization, and can we use technology to automate part of the system? Like today, you will find that we go for online recruitment, online performance management, even training and development is happening online, right? So most of things could be automated, and we can also measure how well these processes and systems are working today. Okay, so now we are moving to another part, especially related to talent management. So what exactly it involves? How do we go about it? Some of the points I've already talked about here. So moving next, we are going to see, if you look at this, these are the things at the periphery, and that is where you see is talent management at the center. So if you look at these points that talks about remuneration is important, succession planning is important, how you are going to able to retain talent in the organization, and the most important thing is that what is your talent identification and strategy, how do I identify talent, and what your strategies for managing talent. So we'll talk about these things, and here in talent management sense we also talk about the employee value proposition. What I'm trying to discuss here is that when I'm talking about talent retention, that you are not going to retain everybody. There's no point retaining everyone, but you are going to retain the talented people, because it is the talent which is going to contribute to the performance, right? But in order to do that, we also need to ensure that you have a good succession plan in the organization, so that people know that they have career and growth opportunities. You also reward them appropriately, so that they're happy and satisfied. And at the last, you will find here it is written 360 degree. 360 degree is a feedback system where you get a comprehensive feedback about the employees in terms of their knowledge, their skill, right, and other attitude and behavior from a set of people like supervisors, subordinates, colleagues, even from the market also. So you can add them to the system, and they are going to provide feedback about the people, and that helps you to go for identifying the talent. Once you are able to identify the talent, the next job is that you are going to retain them, right? For retention, two things are important: remuneration and succession plan. If they know that yes, there are growth opportunities available for them in the market, sorry, in the organization, and they are remunerated well in terms of rewards, then you will be able to retain them in the organization, right? So now, if you look at this, these are the points basically we have been talking about, like aligning remuneration to match your talent. Make sure that the remuneration that you are paying to the employees, it is worth the talent that you have. If you are paying less, then you will not be able to retain them, because if they find an opportunity elsewhere, they will flee, right? So it is very, very important to ensure that the kind of reward system that you develop is going to help you to retain employees. Second, identify and understand your people capability and talent requirements. So that is where you need to identify the kind of talent that your people have. Not only this, but you also need to see that what is the requirement of the talent for the organization, and whether there is a match between the two or not. Whether your talent, in terms of capability, knowledge, and skill that you have, and the talent that is required by the organization is matching or not. So it is very, very important to know the kind of talent that people have and that kind of talent that is required by the organization, right? Now, the next thing is that you also need to see how we're going to motivate talent in the organization, right? So in order to motivate your talent, especially top talent, are those who are performing very well, those who have the capability to perform well, you are going to look at these things. Are you rewarding them well? Are you providing them growth opportunities? Are you developing them? So what is your growth strategy, employee development strategy? So all this is going to motivate your top talent to retain with the organization. Moving further, you also need to develop a good retention strategy. So retention strategy is related to that. What are the activities that you need to follow in terms of the development, career plan, and other things so that you are able to retain them. This side, you look at it, attracting and sourcing the right candidate. Now, this is a big issue in most of the organizations. Though we all said and then we say that yes, we are going to retain, we are going to recruit the best people in the organization, but usually it does not happen. There could be internal as well as external factors responsible for this, right? And that is why you are not able to attract the best people in the organization. It depends upon number of factors, like if you are not a good brand in the market, maybe you are not able to recruit the good kind of people. If your HR policy is not good, you may not be able to recruit good people. What kind of management philosophy you have, right? How you treat people in the organization, right? For example, many organizations say that yes, employees are the most important asset for the organization. But in practice, they don't follow these kind of things. Though they say that employees are the most important asset for the organization, but once you join, then they don't treat you as an asset, they treat you as a resource, right? So there could be a number of factors responsible for not able to attract the right kind of candidate in the organization. It all depends upon what is your philosophy, management philosophy, what kind of HR systems and policies you have, what kind of career and succession plan you have, right? What kind of compensation you are going to offer to the organization, what kind of brand you are, right? So there could be a number of factors which help you to attract good candidate. So because if you are not able to have the right kind of candidate, talented people, all other things will not come into the picture. The question of retention management comes only later, because at the first place you need to recruit the best people, right? And then you follow other processes, right? Here we are talking about the employee development activity. This is another core process that we need to look at it. And this is basically related to talent development, right? You know that we are living in an age where most of the knowledge and skill base that we have become obsolete in due course of time because of the changes that is happening in the environment. So there's a need to continuously ensure that people are developed in terms of the knowledge and skill base. They equip themselves with the knowledge and skill which is required by the organization. And that is where you are going to have your training and development strategies. You go for mentoring them, coaching them, allowing them to participate in different kind of training programs so that they are able to develop themselves personally and professionally. That is very, very important. Then, succession plan. What kind of succession plan you have? Now, when I'm talking about succession plan, basically it is related to providing career and growth opportunities to the employees, right? Even mentoring can be used as a instrument for succession plan, where you are going to mentor talented employees to take senior level positions in the organization. So whether an organization has an effective succession plan, are you giving enough signals that those who are doing well will be promoted, they will be rewarded? If that is not there, then your succession plan is not good. And then you may lose out to these good people to other organizations. Because you know that nowadays a lot of job posting and these kind of things are there, and everybody is looking for talent. So if you are not able to offer them a good position with good remuneration, they would leave the organization and join some other place, provided they have an opportunity. Yeah, that is very, very important. Now, we move to the next slide. And if you look at this, it talks about the kind of framework that we have. So this is basically nothing else but an extension of what we have been discussing. So we start with this one. What kind of philosophy management has, what kind of strategy they have about the people. So we need to ensure that HR strategy and organizational strategy are aligned with each other. And that is where we have been talking about the alignment. When I'm talking about organizational strategies in terms of what they want to achieve, in terms of goals and strategy, goals and objectives, and for that, what kind of a strategy they adopt. See, nowadays, most of the organizations have strategies so that they can be more competitive in the market. And these strategies may include like going for diversification, expansion, right, in related unrelated areas. Similarly, they also adopt strategies related to mergers and acquisitions, licensing, franchising, all kind of things. Okay, they are going for cost cutting, right, differentiating this product. You know, Porter talked about two different major strategies, that is cost effectiveness and differentiation, based on which the organization is able to compete. Now, so looking at these strategies at the corporate and the business level, we need to ensure that how it is aligned with the HR strategies. HR strategies, especially related to the talent management goals that the organization has, and also the strategies. Now, you know that if you look at today's situation, the current situations, most of the organizations are not able to retain their talent, or they are not in a position to retain their talent because the organization is not performing well. Now, you have to see that what kind of talent management strategies could be adopted in a crisis, right? So you have to see that how HR is going to help the organization to ensure that the talent management is retained in the talent is managed and retained in the organization. So they need to develop certain strategies in terms of performance management, recruitment, selection, reward system that they have. So all this has to ensure that you have the right kind of talent in your organization. And then you have to see that how this talent is going to contribute to the growth and development of the organization. So they need to be aligned. That is very, very important. Now, when we're talking about HR talent management goals and strategies, these are the four things that need to be done. That is related to retention, diversity, inclusion, engagement, and finally, we have competencies. So competency is the base when we're talking about the proficiency and knowledge and skills. So you need to ensure that people have the right kind of competencies, and you need to develop them to ensure that they are able to contribute to the goals and objectives of the organization. Then you also need to see that how you're going to retain. So as a part of your retention strategy, you need to look at your reward system and also the career management. And you also need to provide them a good leadership, supportive leadership, and succession plan. What kind of succession plan you have? So career management, leadership, and succession plan along with the reward is a part of your retention strategy. And this is a part of your acquisition strategy. Then you also need to see that how we are going to select and acquire talent in the organization, right? So you also follow the principles of diversity and inclusion, which is also mandated by our constitution and the government. We are going to select people from all walks of life, all kind of people from different spheres, right? So that is where we're talking about diversity. So you need to include everybody to ensure that any kind of talent which is available anywhere is a part of your organization depending upon the requirement of the business, right? And then how you keep them engaged. Engagement is also a part of the process. That is, we are going to review your people, see the kind of talent that they have, whether they need to be developed or not, and then you develop their development strategy. So acquisition, development, right, skill in improving the skill base and retention, these are the most important activities, especially related to talent management. What I'm trying to tell you that these HR strategies related to talent management must be aligned with the goals and objectives of the organization. It does not mean that you have a talent, but if this talent is not going to be useful for the organization in terms of producing results, then it is not required. So you are going to look at two things, that is person job fit and person organization fit. And based on this, you develop these strategies and to see that whether it is going to help you to improve your business performance or not. The extent to which you are able to add value to the organization or the system. Moving further, I'm going to talk about, see what are the main characteristics of a good talent management system and organization. So when we are talking about a good talent management system, we have already talked about that how we're going to recruit good people, engage them, ensure that they have the capabilities, and then what is your retention policy. So based on that, we have identified certain characteristics like ownership and involvement that is related to empowerment and engagement. You need to empower employees to decide how they are going to do, what they are going to do in the broader framework of the business, and the extent to which they are going to be engage themselves in various activities. So empowerment basically leads to engagement, right? And whether the business objectives has percolated down from the organization to the department to the unit to the individual. So everybody should be clear that, okay, what they are supposed to contribute based on the knowledge and skill base, and it should, and what is the target that they need to achieve. Okay, so what I mean by business objectives here is that business objectives of not only of the organization but the department that a department has to achieve, and also the individuals in what they are going to contribute to the objectives of the department or unit, and how various departments are going to contribute to the performance of the organization, so that there is a better alignment between individual goals, department goals, and organizational goals. And everybody should be communicated about it. And then you also need to measure it. Measure the performance of the people, the individual, the group, the departments, and also the organization, so you know the extent to which they have been able to contribute to the organization. Then some of the points we have already discussed, that is you need to recruit the right kind of people. Right kind of people means you make sure that you have best job fit, person job fit, in terms of the knowledge and skill and also their attitude, so that they are able to perform. Acclimate new employees means that you need to ensure that if a new person is employed in the organization, he is acclimated. What I mean by acclimated, that he need to be trained and developed in a such a way so that he becomes familiar with the systems and norms of the organization. I'm talking about the culture, through socialization, other processes, through orientation and other activities, so that he becomes a part of the organization. So you need to ensure that a new employee who has just joined the organization, gradually within a short span of time, is a part of the organization, and that is where you are going to ensure that he is able to develop the same norms and value systems which the other employees in the organization has. You also need to ensure that what are his career interests, right? And then you put him into the right kind of job, right? For example, if a person is in the production department but he is more interested to other kind of activities, so you need to shift him from, because that is where he is going to do better than where he is right now. So you need to ensure a better fit between the person and job based upon his interests, career interests. Because if an employee who has joined the organization is not interested in doing his job, then you cannot expect from him to do well, right? So you need to ensure that you are going to match his interest with the kind of job that you have. And if you find that it is not possible, then it is better not to recruit such people. Then in the process of development, you also see that how we are going to develop, what kind of development opportunities are available for them individuals, through networking, through mentoring, through coaching, through training and development activities, right? So all these basically provide them development opportunities. So you need to communicate to the employees what are the development opportunities that exist in the organization on the personal and professional front, so that he can decide where he wants to go, what kind of things that he is interested to do, and accordingly he is able to develop himself. So these development opportunities, training opportunities, all this must be identified for the individual so that he is able to grow and develop himself. And if that happens, you know that it is going to have a better fit between the person and the job. And then you offer better, appropriate reward and recognition, intrinsically and extrinsically both, right? When I'm talking about recognition, it could be in terms of giving them challenging assignments, right? Recognizing the merit of the people, right? And reward could be external, like rewarding them with money and other kind of things, promoting him to senior positions with better packages. So all this is a part of what you call a good talent management system, and also help them. Also help them to grow and develop. It means the role of the management is to facilitate this process, So he does not feel that any barrier in his growth and development in terms of his career and other kind of things. And so that you need to create a workplace that has meaning and purpose. So a person who, if he finds that, okay, this is the right place to work, where he has the opportunities for development, has opportunities for career growth, he will be taken care in terms of the needs and expectations and rewards. Definitely he would find some purpose to stay back in the organization. And if that is not happening, he might keep on working because of certain compulsions, but he will not be able to, or he would not like to utilize his talent, because the system is not creating a kind of culture, a process which is going to be very rewarding. Moving to the next part, so how we go about identifying the talent so that we can use them or manage them effectively. Here you are going to look at these 4 points. That is, yes, you need to identify the key roles where the talent is required. Not necessary that all the jobs in the organizations require talent. Okay, there could be some mechanical jobs, there could be some other jobs where you people with normal set of skills and knowledge can perform well. But you need to identify that those key roles where you really need talent. And then you identify whether these roles are filled with the talented people or not. Okay. And then you take an inventory of your talent management skills. You see who are having those talents which is fitting with the requirements of the organization. Right. And then you measure their talent and see whether they can fit into it or not. If they are not fitting, then you are going to develop them so that they fit into the particular role. Okay. And then you have a feedback system in the organization to know how your talent is working at each and every level. So if you take care of these points, probably you will be able to manage your talent better, because any kind of talent requires certain roles which is full of challenge, recognition, status. That is what talented people are looking forward to, in addition to the good reward. So if you do not have such people, then probably your organization is not going to perform well. So you need to ensure that you are able to identify talent. You are going to measure the level of talent. You are developing them by getting feedback. And that is where we talked about 360 degree feedback that could be used for developing them. Moving further, this is how we go about it. This is the process we have talked about. This side is the value proposition, and here how we go about retention. If you look at this, the most important thing is that you need to ensure that on a regular basis, you are developing talent who could take leadership position in the organization. Right? So the basic idea of managing the talent is building the leadership supply so that you are not going to have a dearth of leaders, and that is where you are not going to groom people down the line so that they can take positions, senior level positions, and that is where basically you can groom leaders in the organization. And this requires this kind of approach. So it's a kind of value proposition which is being suggested. Acquiring talent, how are we going to acquire talent? This depends upon what kind of recruitment strategy you have, right? What kind of people you are recruiting? So you need to ensure that you have a philosophy and a system of recruitment and selection through which you are able to get the best talent in your organization. Of course, there could be a lot of constraints when it comes to selecting people, and sometimes for certain regions, we are not able to get the best talent in the organization. But given the constraints that we have, we need to ensure that we are able to get the best people. So try to ensure that you are going to select the right kind of people. Okay. Sometimes what happens, we select people who are not good. But sometimes we also select people who could have been rejected, right? So you need to ensure that you are going to select the right kind of people, not those who could perform don't select those who are not able to perform well, are not likely to perform well in the future, or don't select such people who are not good. Given the constraints, sometimes it might be possible that you are not able to acquire good talent because the talent may not be available to you in the market. But in a labor surplus economy in India, I don't think there's a dearth of talent except for some jobs, and there's a huge talent available. So it all depends upon the philosophy and other kind of things, system in the organization which they follow for acquiring talent. Then once you have acquired, you look at the level of talent they have, assess new and current talent. New talents mean what kind of talent that you have acquired and what kind of talent that you have in the organization. And once you are able to identify the level of talent that people have, then you try to develop them. And this development actually depends upon the requirement of the organization. And that is where here we talk about person job fit, and here we are talking about person environment fit, so that you are able to identify that whether the kind of talent that is being developed by you is meeting the requirement of the organization or not. And that is where you need to develop the talent. Okay. Once you have developed the talent through education and development activities, then you ensure that this talent is being utilized by the organization to perform well. Okay. So when we are talking about the transitioning to the talent, basically you need to see that what is your retention strategy, how are we going to retain them. So based on this transition, when they are able to utilize their talent for the benefit of the organization, and then and you are taking care of this talent in terms of the career growth, succession plan, the reward system that you have, reward and performance management system, you will be able to retain the talent in the organization. Okay? Right. So look at the talent acquisition. This is the first part. That is where we go by recruitment and selection, right? So get away from the fill-in-the-box thinking to one that is more proactive. For example, most of us think that, okay, there is a vacancy, so we go for advertisement, whatever applications are there, let us fill the vacancies. Okay. So this is more reactive. So you need to plan about your manpower requirement well in advance, and that is where you are going to be proactive to ensure that you are going to fill the right kind of people. Not just fill in the box, but fill in the box with the right kind of people. And that is where your approach has to be more proactive. Okay. And then build the skill sets required to achieve business purpose. Make sure that there is a better person organization fit. Okay. You are going to recruit people with such skills and develop them also in the future, which is going to help them to achieve the goals and objectives of the organization. Because if with this right, the kind of skill set that people have, they are not able to contribute to business performance, then that skill set is not required, at least for that particular organization. Okay. And then identify the top performers. Okay. Who are not really looking for another job. Because in most cases, you'll find that those who are performing are looking forward to a job based upon their talent in other organizations. Okay. But you need to focus on those performers who want to stay back in the organization. Because if somebody wants to leave, it would be difficult for an organization to retain them. Anyway, they are going to leave. Even if you develop them, you train them, it is very difficult to stop them, right? If somebody wants to leave, most of the time, organization does not have an plan that how to stop them. Maybe sometimes they offer more salary, better position, but these are short-term measures, but it does not work actually. Okay. So when it comes to recruitment, you also look at these things. What is the characteristics of a workforce, the current workforce, and the one that you are going to recruit in future? I'm talking about the workforce characteristics in terms of their various characteristics like their current skills, their performance, also the kind of talent they have, okay, what is their age, and all kind of things that is related to demography. Then look at the economic issues impacting organizational sustainability, how the organization is doing in terms of its performance, because it all depends upon the performance of the organization in terms of how productive they are, how much revenue they are able to generate, and whether they are going to work on a sustainable basis or not, right? Because if an organization who is sustainable on an economic basis can go for a better selection, or that could be most preferred by an organization in terms of, sorry, people, when it comes to recruitment, right? And there could be a lot of cultural issues also. Sorry. You also need to look at the organizational cultural issues impacting talent acquisition. What kind of management philosophy you have? What kind of culture you have? Whether you really are you really interested to recruit talented people? Are you interested in recruiting mediocre with paying less salary and allow them to, I mean, ask them to work and to be efficient, right? So if an organization has a culture who thinks that, okay, we will hire whatever people are available, we will pay them less salary, and they are going to work for us because they have no other option. So in that case, it is very difficult for you to get talent for the organization. Okay. And similarly, you also need to identify what are the trends in the industry, what are the industries which are growing, what are industries which are not growing, so, and what are the emerging issues in the industries, what kind of problems industries are facing. Okay. You know, there are certain industries which are really facing crisis. If you look at the current situation, you can see that certain businesses are not doing well, are not performing well. Certain businesses have been closed. Most of the MSMEs are not performing well. They have been closed down. Employees have been asked to leave the organization, right? So there could be a lot of issues. Sometimes it is predictable. Sometimes it is not predictable. So you have to identify what kind of trends are going on in the industry, whether industry is going through crisis or it is going through a growth situation, because that is going to change the whole situation or scenario when it comes to recruitment. Okay, so talent acquisition depends on a lot of things, and that is where you are going to be more proactive. Make sure that there is a better person job fit and better organization fit. Look at those who want to stay with your organization, good people, are talented people. Don't look at those who want to leave, even if they are talented. Moving to the next part. So who should own the talent strategy? Who is responsible? See, these are the 5 points that we have discussed. It is very important to manage talent because leadership, you are going to build the leadership. Performance management is also a strategy that is used. Hiring the best people we have talked about. Having a good performance-driven culture. High level of engagement and retainment. Now, this is a survey based on various people, and see what they say. CEOs say that yes, it is important. Leadership development is very, very important. But HR managers who own the process, they look at it negatively. Lines of business own, HR supports is average. Right? Lines of business own independently is negative. Right? So what I'm trying to tell you that, see, if you look at talent management strategy, especially it is the responsibility of the top management. What kind of philosophy and approach they have for employees is really a matter of concern, because if you look at HR managers or business managers or others, they could be seen as less concerned, and that is where you will find those who own the processes, whether the senior managers or the CEOs, they are basically own this strategy, and they should work for it to ensure that they are able to build leadership, so that leadership development, basically it is related to succession plan, so that from bottom to top, they have talented people working in the organization. Okay, and these are the points that we have already discussed, like yes, you have to have a good performance management system, select the best people available, given the constraints that you have. have a performance driven culture, it means that you need to promote people based on the culture, performance, and make sure that you are able to engage them through providing better career opportunities, a good reward system, and that is what is going to help you to retain people in the organization. Okay. Moving further, see, these are the strategies for talent acquisition. Set your records straight. Have benchmark, establish a talent standard. Okay, and this is what you want. So you need to create a difference in terms of performance. Okay, this is a poor performance, this is average performance, this is excellent performance. And this could be used for evaluation and promotion also. Okay. So this is going to help you to ensure that you are able to get good talent and make sure that you are going to focus more on those who are excellent performers down the line from the top to bottom, and make sure that it is going to influence your people related decision throughout the organization. Okay. And make sure that you are able to probe the talent which is available in the organization and see that what needs to be done with this talent, how they are going to utilize the talent, and then the manager should be made accountable and responsible to ensure that how they are going to increase the strength of the talented pool. Last but not the least, you need to go for poaching also. See where the talent is available. Other organizations, outside the organization, wherever it is, you need to ensure that you are able to get them with you. See. This is something that is the old mindset so far as people management system is concerned, right? The notion is that people are our most important asset. Is it so? And who's responsible for people management? HR. And then you conduct some succession plan to tell that this is what we have and that is how people can grow in the organization. And I work with the people I inherit. So whatever people we have, I'm going to work with them. Right, so this shows a very hopeless situation. Now we need to move from this old mindset to this new mindset that yes, you don't work with the people that you have, you are going to work with the people who are really talented because they are going to contribute to better performance. And managers are responsible to ensure that they are able to recruit and retain the talent in the organization. So the talent management is very, very important because it actually everything depends upon the talent managers. So they become a central part for the entire organization because everything depends upon the talent which managers have to contribute. And then you take some bold actions to build the talent pool. It is not the kind of people that I have, I will work with them. Okay? Sometimes managers say that, okay, what can I do? These are the people and I have to take, I have to ask them to work. So whatever they're doing, it's all right. No, that kind of mindset is to be changed. You need to ensure that how you can go for developing these people so that they become a talent. Okay. Now moving further. So ultimately, it boils down to how we can balance the need of the individual and the organization. See, if you look at this, it would be clear to you. Here we are talking about organizational needs and here we are talking about individual needs. These are the strategies. And that is what they are looking forward to. They want to see what is the current competencies of the organization, which is required, what kind of competencies would be required by the organization in the future, what kind of changes is happening in the market, and what kind of strategies they are adopting, mergers, joint ventures, and whether they need to go for innovation and growth or not. Because unless organizations innovate in terms of their product or services, it is not possible for them to grow and develop. Okay. And for innovation, what the most basic thing that you require is the knowledge and skill base of the people. And for that, sometimes because of the requirement of the environment, they go for right sizing or downsizing today, that's what you call, or restructuring their businesses. Okay. The idea is that these strategic issues are linked with the operational issues, right? they want to ensure that the employee turnover level is less. People work, engage and commit themselves. They have a talented pool of the employees. And if not, then they are going to outsource. Now, you know that a lot of functions in the management or the businesses are being outsourced today as a part of their cost-cutting exercises. And the major concern is productivity. With these things, now if you look at the individuals, what people are looking forward in terms of their needs and expectations. These are the personal characteristics of the people. Age, tenure, family concerns, spouse, employee development, mobility, other kind of interests that people have. And on the professional front, at what level of career they are, what is their level of education training, whether they really want to be get promoted or not, how is their performance level. We also measure potential, whether they have potential to grow and develop or not. And when it comes to talent management, we also need to measure the potential, whether what kind of things these people can do, given an opportunity in the future, and what kind of career path is available to them, right? So you need to balance these two things, and that is where career management is very, very important. Through career management, you can see that how you can go about balancing the needs of the organization and the individual needs, because individual is looking for something different. They are looking for promotion, performance, what kind of career path is available in the organization, and what organization is looking for? Competencies in you, right? So they have strategies, they want to grow and innovate themselves. So they want to see that they have a talented pool who is going to be productive. Okay. Another issue that is very, very important, I don't know whether you're familiar with this, there is known as psychological contract. See, psychological contract is something that goes beyond job description. Okay. I mean, that is something that is and kind of obligation, you can say. It is not something that is written somewhere, because job contracts does not talk about psychological contracts. It is some kind of expectations that both individuals and organizations will have in terms of contributing to each other, right? So what organizations expect from individuals? That they will put in effort, they would be loyal, they will be using their skill and time and competencies so that the organization grows. What individuals expect from the organizations? Good pay, good job security, good benefits, career opportunities, succession plan, good succession plan so that they can move up in the career ladder, and promotional opportunities. See, is it possible to match these two things or not? Part of that could be that yes, pay, benefits, the part of the formal job description, but contributions from the employees that an organization expects is something that is a kind of obligation that you have to contribute to the organization by being a part of the organization. So psychological contract also play a very important role. And then you have to see whether people understand the realities that yes, they need to contribute, they have to be loyal, they need to make an effort, use their competencies for the benefit of the organization. In anticipation that yes, organization will take care of their needs, expectations, careers, promotions, and other kind of things. So it is a kind of exchange that happens between the organization and individual. That yes, if you take care of me, I will take care of you. And that is what basically psychological contract talks about. Look at this. Then the leadership management. Ultimately, this talent is being developed to take leadership position in the organization. So what kind of characteristics is required? What kind of things that need to be developed? These are the different kind of skills that employees need to develop in terms of their competencies so that they could take up leadership positions. The interpersonal skills, communication, they have to be effective in their communication. They are able to work in team. They are flexible enough. They are able to develop good relationship. They have those leadership capabilities. They are able to visualize the future of the organization. So the visioning process through which you are able to visualize the future of the organization, a future of your also. Coaching and training. Your the peers and the subordinates to grow and develop them, and then whether you can create and lead teams or not. So if you have these competencies developed, then you are building leaders. Okay, so you need to ensure that your talent has these kind of skills so that they can take up leadership roles. Okay, moving further, so that is how you go about developing the leader. And this is a part of what you call acquisition, retention, or management. This is a part of your management strategy. Talent, how you are going to manage talent so that they are able to retain. Because acquisition leads to management, and management leads to retention of the talent. So this is a part of your strategy. Power learning. Is there an issue?
Sir, you have to resume your presentation. One of the participants accidentally shared her screen. So I have to click on the resume presentation option.
Okay.
Yes, okay? Sir, it is visible now. Yes, okay. Sir, it's okay.
So you have to see that how you are going to develop leaders, and for that you need to develop your strategy in terms of what kind of experience is required, how you go about feedback and coaching, how you're going to train them, right? So if this goes up, if this goes down, see what happens. Ascending values, that is how you are going to develop it. Training, feedback, job performance, coaching and feedback, and experience. And this helps you to increase the value of the employees so that you are able to develop the leaders. I think I'm taking more than the stipulated time anyway. I will try to finish as early as possible. Then coaching is also very important, especially coaching to improve the performance of the organization. Okay. So there's a difference between personal and executive coaching. You set the goal of the business and see whether business leader can achieve them given the environment in which they are working. So you need to focus on these kind of things. These are the talents that is required at the leadership level. So they need to develop multifaceted talent in different areas, that how well they manage their time, finances, projects, whether they can work effectively in team or not. So these are the things that need to be focused upon when it comes to coaching the people for performance improvement. Then team building and another important thing. So this is a talent which is required in today's scenario, because most of the things are not going to be individual centered, task centered, but it is going to be process centered. So as we are moving from task centered activities to process centered activity in the organization, most of the people are going to work in teams. So you have to see that you are able to develop good teams who are going to effectively work in a team. And that is where it is very, very important, so that they can achieve the goals and objectives. So team building is another important activities. So, you know, team is defined as together everyone achieves more. So that creates a more synergistic effect on the organization and the performance of the people. Okay. So you have to see that when you're going to develop team, it depends upon interdependence, because in team, everybody depends upon each other. They specify the goals and objectives that they want to achieve. They have a single aim. So everybody should act cohesively, and that they develop norms and values so that through which they are able to achieve the goals and objectives. And then they communicate with each other quite often so that they know the needs and expectations, and so that they can work together. So these are some of the issues related to team building activities. Then another important thing is succession planning. It is very, very important when it comes to retaining talent, right? So you need to identify who is going to succeed on key positions in the organization. Okay? And what kind of development activities and career moves are required by the people to take the position as a successor. So succession planning is very, very important in the organization, because creates a continuum of leadership from top to bottom, and you re it also helps you to retain people down the line, because they know that they have growth opportunities. They would be happy and satisfied. Probably it also brings more commitment and satisfaction on the part of the employees, because they know that they are going to promote it to the next level, provided they have that required talent for that particular position. And if you have this kind of system, basically it also helps to improve your branding as an organization. So succession planning is another strategy that could be used for retention of the employees. Now look at some of the facts. This is based on a research. Look at these facts. I don't know how whether it is correct or not, but this is a fact about some of the organizations, especially service organizations, that is more visible compared to manufacturing, other kind of organizations. 50% of the people recruited in the organization will leave within 2 years. 1 in 4 people recruited leaves within 6 months. 70% of organizations report that staff turnover has a negative impact, because if employees leave, then it will have a negative impact on the performance. So, and that is why talent retention is very, very important. Okay. And replacement cost is very high, because once you recruit a new person, you need to train them, need to ensure that his performance is at par with those who has left. Okay. And 50% of organizations experience regular problems with employee retention. So the kind of strategies that we have discussed related to talent retention, like having a good performance management system, succession plan, other kind of things, really help going, it's going to help you. So is it an issue for the top HR? Yes. Why? Because if people leave, the job of the HR increases, because employee replacement cost is very high, and sometimes it is not possible to get good people when it is required by the organization. Okay. Recruitment is still not very perfect, and it is very difficult to recruit the matching kind of person which has left the organization. And also recruitment cost, replacement cost, training cost, all kind of costs, cost that is associated with employee turnover is very, very high. And if employees are leaving, then probably you are losing a talent. And that is where it is very, very important to have your policies and systems in place so that you are able to retain good employees. So these are some of the tools. What you need to do, provide them good career development opportunity. All said and done, these are the ideal situations. I don't know what exactly happens in the organization, but most of the organizations, if they are able to follow in partly, probably they will be able to retain at least a percentage of their talented pool, like providing them good career development opportunity, sense of accomplishment. It means through recognition and other kind of things, you make sure that you communicate with them that yes, you have achieved something that is worthwhile. Job security. See, today in today's scenario, basically we do not talk about job security, but we should talk about career security. Because if you have employable skills, probably you will get a job somewhere, right? But when it comes to retaining tool, yes, if you have a system of secure jobs, then probably they would like to stay with that organization compared to an organization where there is no job security. Confidence in future. They know that, yes, organization will take care of them in terms of their improving their knowledge and skills, in developing them, and providing them career opportunities in the future. So if they have confidence in their future, depending upon the organizational activities, kind of organizational career path that they have, then probably this confidence builds up. Another factor that is very important is that whether organization is doing well or not. If organization is doing well, that also creates confidence in the future. Then, of course, good compensation, that is an enabler. Recognition, yes, you need to recognize. While compensation is an extrinsic factor, recognition is an intrinsic factor. And evaluating job performance, how you evaluate performance. So, and that is why you have to have a practice where you are able to fairly discriminate between good performers and bad performers, right? So these are some of the strategies that could be adopted for managing the talent. Then you tell your boss that, yes, look at some of the things. there is a shortage of talent at the leadership positions. Most of the organizations don't have talented leaders today. And if you do not have talent, it is going to affect the shareholders' value, because the organization is not going to perform well. If the market growth is not there, profit is not being made, then definitely shareholders' value is going to be affected. Employee turnover costs money. You need to make them understand, your leadership, that yes, if employees are leaving, it is a loss for them. And you have a diverse workforce, so their needs and expectations are different. So you need to create your HR policy in such a way so that you are able to take care of your employees, which is very, very diverse in terms of their needs and expectations because of the age, reason, culture, whatever it is. And then you need to plan your workforce and develop them. And that is why, you know, you need to every year organizations go for employee plan, workforce planning, identifying the kind of requirement that they have and whether they have the right kind of people or not, and then develop them. And finally, it's a core process. How we go about it? At the strategic level, you have a talent plan. You need to align your HR and line manager's activities to ensure that we have a talent management strategy. These are the pillars. Role, critical activities from the HR. And you also use workforce data analytics to identify the trends and patterns. What is happening? So, for example, you can use various metrics to identify it, how people are performing, how many people are, what is the turnover rate, right? So that is where metrics and the analytics comes into the picture to identify the trend and the pattern. Then you develop your talent. This is your foundation. So what is your talent strategy? You need to translate your business strategy into organizational capabilities. You need to ensure that based upon your business requirement, whether people have the talent or not. So that is where we are talking about person organization fit. Right? It means that whether you have the kind of people and both the number and the quality of people who could help you to fulfill your business objectives or not. Okay. So ultimately you have bedrock. It means that you must understand what is the business strategy and what are its talent implications. Well, when I'm talking about talent implications, it means what kind of people would be required to achieve the goals and objectives of the organization, right? So I think with this, I'm going to conclude my lecture. Thank you for your patience to hear me. If you have any queries, then you can ask me. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. If any of the participants have any questions, they can unmute your mic in one by one, and you can ask your questions, or you can also post your questions in the chat box. I'll read out all the questions that have been posted in.